The diesel cycle is the ideal version of a compression ignition engine, and it's one of the most common gas power cycles. It shares many characteristics found in the Otto cycle, which we covered in a previous 10-minute lecture, link below. Just like the Otto cycle, the diesel cycle takes the energy of combusting a fuel and air mixture to produce mechanical work. The main difference is that in a diesel cycle, we don't have a spark that initiates the combustion. Diesel cycles are the ideal cycle for a compression ignition engine, just like Otto cycles are the ideal cycle for a spark ignition engine. The stages of these engines are roughly the same. We take state 1 as the piston's head being all the way down. Remember, we call this the bottom dead center, or BDC. The intake and exhaust valves are closed at this stage. The first difference we see with respect to the Otto cycle is that only air is inside this maximum volume, not an air-fuel mixture. The first stroke compresses the air, making it decrease its volume and increase its pressure. The fuel injection process begins when the piston is reaching the top dead center position, and it continues during the first part of the power stroke. The reason for this is that diesel fuel auto-ignites when the temperature reaches a certain value. It doesn't need a spark to make the mixture combust. Therefore, what the compression does to the air as it increases the pressure and reduces the volume is make the temperature rise to a value where the diesel fuel that is going to be injected will ignite immediately. In other words, the combustion process starts as soon as the fuel is injected into the hot air. As you can probably tell, the other difference here is that not all the mixture combusts instantaneously, like it almost does in an Otto cycle. There, the spark makes the already mixed fuel combust in an instant. Here, we cannot inject the fuel all at once. No matter how quickly we do it, or what is the same, how high the mass flow rate is, the piston will start moving down, power stroke, while we're still injecting fuel. This is why we say that the injection process continues during the first part of the power stroke. Other than this, everything else is very similar to the Otto cycle. After the fuel injection ends, the piston keeps pushing down. Once the piston reaches BDC again, the exhaust valves open, and the piston moves up to flush the exhaust gases. At this point, the exhaust valve closes and the intake valve opens to allow fresh air to come in when the piston moves back down. Just like with the simplification of this process we did for the Otto cycle, in the diesel cycle we can assume that our working substance is air only, that after combustion we still have air, and most importantly, that between 4 and 1 this air is just releasing heat, so that it goes back to a fresh and cold air state at 1 without all the flushing and intake steps. So as you can see, the main difference occurs between 2 and 3. Let's see these processes on a PV diagram and on a TS diagram. We begin with uncompressed and cold air at state 1. This would be low pressure and large volume, which is the bottom right in the PV diagram, and low temperature and low entropy, or bottom left in the TS diagram. From 1 to 2, we still have compression of air, just like we did in an Otto cycle. So just like we showed then, and remembering that these are ideal cycles, we will assume an isentropic increase in temperature and an isentropic increase in pressure while reducing the volume. Now, from 2 to 3, we used to add a spark that made the mixture combust in an instant. Because of that, we made the assumption of an isochoric heat addition process. We assume that the mixture was combusting before the volume had a chance to change. But in this case, we are injecting the fuel, and the piston head is already moving as more fuel is coming in. And what do we usually have in a piston cylinder system where the piston's head is allowed to move freely? This would be an isobaric process. So the main difference here is that the pressure is not increasing in a constant volume space as we add heat, like the Otto cycle, but that the pressure remains constant during the heat addition process. As soon as the fuel is injected, it burns, adding heat, and the piston moves. More fuel is injected, more heat comes in, and the piston moves some more. And of course, this is happening continuously, not discretely. Therefore, from 2 to 3 we move on a constant pressure line, horizontally on the PV diagram, and a curve that has a gentler slope than a constant volume 1 on the TS diagram. The rest of the expansion happens between 3 and 4, which results in work out, and we assume it to be isentropic as well. And remember that from 4 to 1, we're substituting the flushing of exhaust gases and intake of fresh air as just air cooling down as heat is put out. This would still happen at constant volume, like in the Otto cycle. What all this means in terms of energy conservation is that the compression and expansion are still isentropic, which implies adiabatic. Therefore, our first law equation yields minus W equals delta U. But these are not important, as we'll be using Qin and Qout for most of our calculations. From 4 to 1, we're assuming constant volume, and therefore Q equals delta U. And the only difference here with respect to the Otto cycle is that from 2 to 3, we are assuming constant pressure, not volume. Therefore, either remember that heat for an isobaric process is the change of enthalpy, or again, just from the first law, heat is delta U plus W, which is the very definition of enthalpy. Notice that between 2 and 3, the volume is changing. As opposed to the Otto cycle, we don't have one volume ratio between the only two volume values. In this case, we have a total of 3 volume values, 1 equal to 4, 2, and 3. For this reason, we still refer to the compression ratio as V1 over V2, or V4 over V2, since V1 is also V4, but we introduce a new volume ratio called the cutoff ratio, R sub C. This is the ratio between the volume after and before the combustion process, V3 over V2. It's called cutoff because stage 3 is when the fuel stops being injected. Compression ratios are usually around 6 to 12 for spark ignition engines because we don't want them to self-ignite. Additionally, fuels like gasoline have to be refined so that they don't combust before we want them to. This is closely related to the octane levels. The higher the octane levels, the less likely the gas will combust at an incorrect time. But that's a whole other topic. This is all to say that diesel fuels are less refined and usually much cheaper than gas. In the US, diesel is more expensive than gas mainly because of taxes. Taxes that are used to maintain roads that are usually worn out by heavier transportation trucks that are usually diesel. But again, that's another topic for another day. The point here is that since what we are compressing initially is air only, not a mixture, diesel engines can be designed to operate at compression ratios between 12 and 24. Let's look at a short example where we use cutoff ratios and the main differences for diesel cycles, and if you want to watch other more complex examples on diesel cycles, make sure to check out the links in the description of this video. An ideal diesel cycle takes air at 92 kPa and 290 Kelvin, and has a cutoff ratio of 2 and a compression ratio of 16. What is the temperature after the heat addition process, and how much heat is added by the combustion? Pause here and take a minute to think about this before you watch the solution. Since air is an ideal gas, we can find the relationship between T3 and T2 in terms of V2 and V3 and P2 and P3. And since we learned from this lecture that the heat addition process is isobaric, we see that T3 is only a function of T2 and the cutoff ratio. This means that we can find T3 if we know T2. To find T2, which is the final temperature after an isentropic compression process between 1 and 2, we know that we can use the relative volume values. Since we have the compression ratio, which is V1 over V2, we can use T1 to find VR1, and this will give us VR2. That way, T2 is just the temperature that corresponds to VR2. So let's do that. We look up VR1 for 290 Kelvin. We use the compression ratio to calculate VR2, and with this value, we interpolate to find the temperature that corresponds to VR2. We substitute the T2 temperature and find that T3, the temperature at the heat addition process, is 1675 Kelvin. Now for the added heat, we learned today that Qn is just H3 minus H2. And since we now have both T2 and T3, we go to our tables and find the H values that correspond to these temperatures. We interpolate for both, and we find that the heat added was 986 kilojoules per kilogram. For more complex problems on diesel cycles, make sure to check out the links in the video description. You will also find links to the other lectures of the thermo course, as well as the playlists of the other engineering courses. Thanks for watching!